Each year we bring one of the giants in public interest law to deliver the annual Al Meyerhoff public interest lecture, and we truly have one of the giants in American public interest law here today. Sherrilyn Ifill is the 7th President, Director-Counsel of the NAACP Legal Defense Fund. She went to college at Vassar College, she went to NYU Law School, and she was telling me as we were walking over that, like Al Meyerhoff, she went to law school because she wanted to be a public interest lawyer. She also said that she really enjoyed law school because she went knowing exactly what she wanted to do. And she spent her career as a public interest lawyer. She was initially a fellow at the American Civil Liberties Union. She then spent a number of years as staff attorney at the NAACP Legal Defense Fund. In 1993, she became a professor at the University of Maryland Law School. She was a distinguished scholar, writing influential books and articles. She was a legendary teacher. One thing that I didn't get to tell you is every year I would go to Baltimore to do Barbary lecturing. And I'd always talk to the students in every city about who were your favorite teachers. And the University of Maryland students would always mention you first as the teacher they most admired, and so just legendary as a teacher. And also she continued to be an activist, a lawyer during her time as an academic. She was recruited, enticed, in January of 2013,
Shanghai,
to be the 7th President and Director Counsel of the NAACP Legal Defense Fund, where she's doing a truly terrific job. So it's my great pleasure to introduce you to the 2016 Al Meyerhoff Public Interest Lecturer, Sherrilyn Ifill.
You know, being in academia for 20 years at University of Maryland, and having been, of course, to law school myself, I know how important it is to have these moments where we pause and we come together and we have an opportunity to talk about what is really happening in the world and the relationship between what is happening in the world to what we are studying, to law. And it's people like the Meyerhoff family who make these opportunities available for us and make it possible for us to have these critical pause moments when we can think and engage. And so I am just thrilled and delighted to be giving this lecture, particularly named after someone who's made such an extraordinary contribution to public interest law. So thank you so much for having me. I also have a very crazy schedule, but love coming to speak at law schools because I do miss being in the classroom. And so I love to have the opportunity to talk to law students and talk to my colleagues in the academy. And I'm particularly pleased to be here and to accept the invitation to come from Dean Chemerinsky, who I admire so greatly. You may not know, but Dean Chemerinsky last year agreed to participate in LDF's annual Civil Rights Training Institute in Virginia. He came and did our Supreme Court review or preview, I can't remember which one it is, and he's coming back for a return engagement this year. But he was so extraordinary and so brilliant, and what he does with no notes, I will have to have notes. But and I have just been such an admirer of this law school. This is just so exciting. And when the law school was being created, and I was just telling Dean Chemerinsky, it seems like it was 3 years ago, but apparently not. It was, you know, it was all the buzz, especially for those of us who are focused on public interest law. And, you know, I just knew that it would be a success under his leadership. And so it's so exciting to be here and actually see in the flesh the physical manifestation of what I've only seen online. And to see the great work that you're doing, and to see terrific colleagues like Song Richardson and others who I've known over the years. Now, I find it very warm in this room, and I am a woman of a certain age, so I may start fanning. Don't be alarmed. So I want to talk a little bit today about history and about what's happening in the country today, and a little bit about what I think we sometimes forget in the course of our focus on what is happening in the political realm and the public realm and the media. But I take very seriously the moment that we're in this country. I did go to law school to become a civil rights lawyer. I wanted to be a civil rights lawyer from the time I was a girl. This seemed to me the most exciting and wonderful thing to do. And I was telling some young people the other day that who've been very involved in the Black Lives Matter movement and so forth. When I was a girl, my father was a kind of political junkie and a social justice junkie. And in those days in New York, it seemed like there were documentaries all the time about the civil rights movement, and my father would make us watch them. And I can remember the feeling that I had as a young kid, and what I felt was that I had missed it. I had missed the thing that obviously I was born for, but it had happened already. And how could it be possible that I missed it? I was just, you know, astonished. But I wanted to be part of those people. I wanted to be part of that feeling that I could see as I watched those documentary films. And it has been the absolute joy and pride of my life to actually be doing the thing I dreamed to do, that to be part of them. And so I take very seriously this work and what it means to do this work. And I take seriously why we need places like UCI, come on in, and why we need to focus on the study of law and the professional development of lawyers who are undergirded with a firm, clear, and solid engagement with the law's history and with the framing of equality and due process and liberty. I have said before, and I continue to say, that we know that a democracy is functioning and healthy, or dysfunctional and ill, by how well the law protects and promotes the needs of those who exist at the bottom and who exist at the margins. And that's why I've often said that the work of civil rights is what I call democracy maintenance work. It's the job of civil rights lawyers and activists to do the maintenance and repair work that keeps a democracy in good working order. Sometimes we need only to make very simple repairs, but there are also times when we discover that the foundations have rotted and the work that we do is more extensive. These are difficult times, but the work must be done or we imperil the very vitality of our democracy. And so it has been sometimes ugly, painful, but necessary work over the last 2 years of raising consciousness about the need to reform policing and indeed our entire criminal justice system. That work has been long needed and engaged by civil rights lawyers and activists, but the powerful witness of young activists armed with cell phone cameras and righteous outrage has compelled the entire nation to confront the cancer eating away at the legitimacy of our justice system. We've been at moments of confrontation like this in the past. My organization over the decades has been one of the principal democracy maintenance organizations in this country. We held up the mirror to this country and compelled the Supreme Court to reconcile the promise of equality in the 14th Amendment with racial subordination and the white supremacist foundation of segregation. We challenged the denial of full citizenship for African Americans by exclusion from the political process, beginning in 1944 with our Supreme Court win in Smith versus Allwright, which ended the all-white Democratic primary in Texas. And by the way, about that case, Thurgood Marshall, who was the first Director-Counsel of the Legal Defense Fund and who litigated some of the most important cases in the canon, including Brown versus Board of Education, called Smith versus Allwright his most important case, because he believed that access to the political process was the key to equality. We even won the first sex discrimination case in the United States Supreme Court, which I think very few people know, Phillips versus Martin Marietta in 1971. In those days, they were not women's rights legal organizations, and Ida Phillips, a white woman, needed the help. Martin Marietta wouldn't hire her because she had school-aged children. And we litigated that case in the Supreme Court and won. We've challenged racism deeply embedded in the death penalty. We've challenged racially disparate placement of environmental burdens near African American communities. We challenge housing discrimination and transportation discrimination and racist police practices and racially disparate suspension and expulsion practices in our nation's schools. Sometimes our challenges are in the federal courts and sometimes they're not. And for decades, we've even been focused on the courts themselves, pushing for diversity among those nominated and confirmed for federal courts, and pushing for Supreme Court justices with a demonstrated commitment to due process, equal protection, and with a true understanding of how the law works or doesn't work in the lives of poor and marginalized people. I'll be honest, for some time, part of my job has been to keep our cases away from the Supreme Court. The strong conservative majority on the court over the past 30 years has whittled away many of the gains of the past and weakened legal protections that we had fought for and won. So the vacancy on the court created by the death of Justice Antonin Scalia has created an opportunity for this to change. And LDF is in the process of reviewing the record of Judge Merrick Garland, who's been nominated by President Obama, and we will release a report in the coming weeks about his record in the context of civil rights. But I must say, whatever the record reveals, we know he's no Justice Scalia, and that's a good thing. So there is an opportunity. But as you know, Republicans in the United States Senate, led by Senate Majority Leader Mitch McConnell, have determined and announced within hours of the public announcement of Justice Scalia's death that they would not hold hearings or a vote on anyone nominated by President Obama this year to fill the vacant seat. Let the voters decide, they insisted, ignoring the 165 million voters who voted a second four-year term to President Obama. Some have been sanguine about the current eight-member court, notwithstanding the fact that the court has before it this term critical cases involving public sector unions, abortion, affirmative action, judicial recusal, the death penalty, and voting rights. As 4-4 decisions were announced in several key and important cases over the last 2 weeks, some are perhaps growing less sanguine. As you know, a 4-4 split, by its nature, acts as an affirmance of the appellate decision below. And thus, the decision in the public union case was a teachers' union case, was a blow to conservatives. And perhaps some are thinking that a 4-4 court has real consequences. Even justices on the court, however, have adopted a sanguine tone. Justice Breyer said, we'll just get the work done. Justice Alito said it would be no problem to have the eight justices just this week. Justice Kagan said the justices are trying very hard to come to consensus. But all in all, there has not been a sense of what I would say is true agitation, concern about the consequences of a 4-4 evenly divided court on critical questions. So I thought I would talk a little bit today about this issue, which encompasses many other issues that I hope we'll talk for in the question and answer period. But I want to talk particularly about the 4-4 court because I've spent quite a bit of time focused on one brief period of time when the court had only eight members as part of a book project I started working on 3 years ago. And I've been reviewing this book project long before Justice Scalia died, but now even more so since he died. I think it has some important lessons for us, and I'd like to share it with you. The story involved in the case is powerful and devastating. It reminds us of perhaps those things we would rather forget, and hopefully will help focus our attention on what is really at stake. Please, no worries. As we have this eight-member Supreme Court. The story I want to tell returns us to that critical period in the days after the Supreme Court decided Brown versus Board of Education on May 17, 1954. So let me set the stage in terms of what was happening in the country and then tell you about the case I want to talk about, Rice versus Sioux City Memorial Park. So you don't need me to tell you that the Supreme Court's decision in Brown versus Board of Education was monumental. It reversed 70 years of precedent, which had given constitutional license to maintain white supremacy and to keep African Americans as second-class citizens. For many jurisdictions in the South, where blacks outnumbered whites, it opened the possibility of ending white political, social, educational, and economic control. And as a result, Brown generated a tremendous amount of fear among white supremacists. The result was what came to be called massive resistance. U.S. Senator Harry Byrd from Virginia began in 1954 to promote among his colleagues in Congress a Southern Manifesto, finally signed by 101 members of the Congress in 1956. Within a month of the Brown decision in 1954, Byrd created a commission focused on stopping any efforts to integrate schools in 1954. And as you probably know, Virginia was the place where in Prince Edward County the schools were closed for 5 years rather than integrate with black students. Representative John Bell Williams from Mississippi coined the term Black Monday on the floor of the Congress to refer to May 17, 1954, and all over the South, Southern leaders at the city, county, state, and federal level announced their intention to resist Brown and vowed that integration would never happen. Because the Supreme Court delayed its review of how Brown would be implemented to 1955, there was a great deal of magical thinking that perhaps integration would just never happen. And so in the months after Brown, it was not as clear as it is to us looking back today that Brown would pull down the entire foundation of legal segregation nationwide. It was decided, as I said, on May 17, 1954, but the decision itself was the product of unusual and unexpected changes in Supreme Court personnel. The sudden and unexpected death of Chief Justice Vinson led to the appointment of Earl Warren as the Chief Justice. Earl Warren had been a governor of California, an attorney general of California. He was a politician. He understood not only the importance of Brown, but also the importance of announcing a short but powerful unanimous decision, which he also did years later in Cooper versus Aaron, the Little Rock Nine case. And in that first year of his tenure, he was maybe at the peak of his power, and he was able to manage and overcome the tentativeness of Justice Frankfurter and other justices and to forge a compromise on the language of the Brown opinion. Justice Vinson, in fact, before his death, was unable to obtain unanimous consensus in Brown and therefore had ordered the case to be re-argued. It was understood that it was likely to be a 5-4 decision, which he knew was not a great thing for a decision this monumental, and so he asked that it be re-argued. His heart attack and sudden death in September 1953 ensured that he would not be present for the re-argument. And so instead it was Earl Warren who shepherded the nine justices to unanimity, even visiting Justice Robert Jackson several times in the hospital where he was convalescing to obtain contributions to the language of the opinion. Despite his illness, Justice Jackson traveled to the court on the day the Brown decision was announced from the bench, yet another show of court unanimity at this momentous and controversial decision as it was presented to the world. But in October 1954, Justice Jackson finally succumbed to the heart ailment that had plagued him throughout the spring and summer of that year, leaving only eight justices on the court. And so it was, with Brown decided in May 1954 and Justice Jackson's death in October 1954, that the case of Rice versus Sioux City Memorial Park came before an eight-person Supreme Court. Rice versus Sioux City Memorial Park concerned the burial of a soldier named Sergeant John Rice, who was killed in Korea in 1951. When he was killed in action, he had already been awarded a Bronze Star, Purple Heart with Oak Leaf Cluster, the Combat Infantryman's Badge with Star, the Korean Service Medal, the United Nations Service Medal, the National Defense Service Medal, the Korean Presidential Unit Citation, the Republic of Korea War Service Medal, the Pacific Theater Medal, and the World War II Victory Medal. He was a bad soldier. And he was killed in 1951 and killed in action in Korea. He had been a soldier in World War II. He had come home in 1945, and he re-upped in 1946 back into the Army because he was unable to find work at home. So when they brought his body home, his wife, Evelyn, signed a contract with Memorial Park in Sioux City, Iowa, for the burial of her husband. She had three young, very young children, Pamela, Tim, and Jean. And she had a sister who was married to her husband's brother. So two sisters married two brothers. And she and her husband, John, had known each other since they were children, and they had been very much in love. And so she was a quite devastated widow. On the day of the funeral, the mourners all gathered, several hundred of them, including several two or three military men, along with Mrs. Rice and her children, at the Sioux City Memorial Park for the funeral where they had the service. When they arrived home, a representative of the cemetery came to Mrs. Rice's home fairly soon after the service and explained to her that unfortunately they would now not be able to bury Sergeant Rice after all. They had seen the mourners who attended the funeral, and now they realized that Sergeant Rice was Native American. Winnebago, in fact. His wife, Edna, was white, and so the cemetery officials, when they signed the contract with her, had not realized that Sergeant Rice was Native American. And I've met and talked with the family and the children who were very young, and even though they were young, they vividly remember what that was like. The fear when they heard the knock on the door, the confusion, the embarrassment, the sense of being overwhelmed and humiliated, and their mother's grief and tears when these men from the cemetery told Mrs. Rice that they would not bury her husband. As I mentioned, because Rice was a decorated soldier, there were members of the military in attendance at the funeral, and these men saw what happened and the refusal of the cemetery officials to bury Sergeant Rice, and they were angry. And they called Washington, D.C. and told what had happened, that one of their fellow soldiers had been left unburied at this cemetery. And within 2 days, the word got to President Truman, and he was outraged. And this is a story about President Truman and the military. You remember he was the proponent of the executive order in 1948 that desegregated the military. He had very strong feelings. He dispatched a whole coterie of FBI agents to investigate a quadruple lynching because two of the men were former soldiers, African-American soldiers. So he's very serious about the treatment of soldiers, and he was very distressed when he heard the story. And he cabled Mrs. Rice, and he told her that her husband could be buried in Arlington National Cemetery, and I think he's believed to be the first Native American buried in Arlington National Cemetery, and he is buried there. And I have visited his grave. And after she passed away in 2006, Evelyn Rice was buried there with him as well. But the representatives of the cemetery had visited Mrs. Rice, and they told her, now that they realized this case was getting a lot of attention, that if she would just sign a document saying that Sergeant Rice was white — they didn't care whether he was white or not, but if she would just attest to the fact that he was white — they would proceed with the burial. And Mrs. Rice, you know, even her children will say this, she was not a civil rights activist. She was not Rosa Parks in that sense. She was not trying to march on Washington. She just didn't understand. She had grown up, her parents had leased land on the Winnebago Reservation. So she had grown up around Native Americans and had known John since she was 9 years old and been in love with him since she was a little girl. He was older than she was, considerably older than she was. And she couldn't understand it, and she said, "I don't understand, if these soldiers could die together, why they can't also be buried together." And so she said, "I don't see anything to be ashamed of in him being Native American, so I just won't sign it, because why should I lie?" And her brother went in the meantime to go and see a lawyer at a law firm in Iowa, and convinced her to go see this lawyer and to sue. And so this law firm took her case. She was very reluctant to do it. She didn't want any attention. She just wanted to raise her kids. But she was convinced to allow the law firm to represent her. And so the case made its way up to the Iowa Supreme Court. And the Iowa Supreme Court ruled against Mrs. Rice in her constitutional challenge to the actions of the Sioux City Memorial Park. And now the case was headed to the United States Supreme Court, the 8-member United States Supreme Court. The case was argued and decided in November 1954. Just 6 months after Brown, and just 6 months after the Supreme Court issued its remarkable decision in Brown, really laying bare the reality of segregation as a form of racial subordination, talking about the harm of segregation on the dignity and self-esteem of black children, articulating the importance of education, and the stigma associated with segregation, the 8-member court split 4-4 on the Rice case. And this, of course, had the effect of affirming the Iowa Supreme Court's decision denying Mrs. Rice's claim. So imagine this. This is just 6 months after the court rules that states cannot enforce segregation in education by law. And actually 6 years after the court held that state courts cannot enforce racially restrictive covenants and housing deeds, right, in Shelley versus Kramer, the Supreme Court affirms the right to enforce segregation in cemeteries. So the living cannot be segregated by law, but the dead can. In the meantime, in January 1955, President Eisenhower announces the nomination of John Marshall Harlan II to fill the seat vacated by Justice Jackson, who had died the year before. So we have the 4-4 decision in Rice with the 8-member court, Now we have a new Supreme Court nominee, just as we have a new Supreme Court nominee now. And that new Supreme Court nominee is Justice John Marshall Harlan II, who ought to have been a very non-controversial candidate. He was, I have referred to him as what used to be called, damning with faint praise, an able lawyer. He was not a profile in courage in any way. He had not made any big mark in the profession. But he was a good, strong business lawyer. His grandfather, of course, was the first Justice John Marshall Harlan, who had written the famous dissent in Plessy versus Ferguson, right? The "our Constitution is colorblind" dissent. And so that was reason enough for some of the segregationist senators like Eastman from Mississippi to worry about this grandson of the Harlans. But something more was really worrying them. And what was worrying them was that Mrs. Rice's attorneys, after the 4-4 decision, sought a rehearing of the case in the Supreme Court with the belief that now there would be a new justice and the case could be decided and might be decided in Mrs. Rice's favor. And so because the petition for rehearing was pending, and because, as I told you, during this period, this is before Brown 2, before the 1955 decision in the second Brown case, which was about the implementation of Brown. You only had Brown 1, you only had the announcement of the principle that segregation was unconstitutional. The stakes were high. Many segregationists really believed that they could stop this train from leaving the station. And they worried about the Rice case, which was back at the court on this petition for rehearing. And as a result, the Rice case became the focus of the confirmation hearings for Supreme Court nominee John Marshall Harlan II, who probably had never heard of an equal protection claim on the behalf of a person before he came before the Senate Judiciary Committee. And what is most interesting about his confirmation hearings is that actually this is the first set of confirmation hearings of the sort that we now take as normal. So there didn't used to be confirmation hearings where the nominee came before the committee and sat for days and answered a variety of questions about their judicial philosophy, right? The stuff that we've all seen with Supreme Court nominees over the past, depending on how old you are, 20 or 30 or 40 years. That actually began with John Marshall Harlan. This was the first one. Yes, there had been questions about Justice Brandeis. There was no question that there was an element of anti-Semitism to the ways in which he was questioned about for certain business dealings. John Parker in 1934 had to withdraw when it was revealed that he had made certain racist statements. But the idea of the nominee appearing before the committee and being asked a wide range of questions about their beliefs and philosophies, particularly about areas related to civil rights, began with this confirmation hearing in February 1955 with John Marshall Harlan. And most of what he was asked about was the Rice case, which is how I came to learn about the case. I kept thinking, what is this about? Why do they keep asking him about this case? So there was this very intense questioning about Rice, and the questions in particular focused on an amicus brief that had been filed, or something that was like an amicus brief that was filed, that talked about the way in which segregation violated the commitments that the United States had just made under the newly signed UN Charter. So this should sound familiar, right? The idea that somehow international obligations were relevant to the question of civil rights. And this had the Southern segregationists up in arms and agitated as well. And Justice Harlan was a nominal member of an organization that had signed a brief talking about the UN Charter. He didn't even remember that he was a member of this organization. But that became the focus of the questioning for him. And so after he went through this very rigorous period before the Senate Judiciary Committee, he was finally confirmed for his seat in February 1955. So now we have a 9-member Supreme Court, and we have a petition for rehearing in the Rice case. And many people believe that the Rice case is going to open up the floodgates if it is decided in the favor of Mrs. Rice, and really end segregation, because Brown could be, many said, seen as being just about education, because the court talked about the importance of education to citizenship and so forth. But swimming pools and parks and cemeteries and all those things could still be segregated, some believed and hoped for. So the Rice case was a particularly important one. So just a few months later, almost a year to the day after the first Brown case was decided, on May 9, 1955, the court issued its decision in the Rice case. In an opinion written by Justice Felix Frankfurter, the court granted the petition for rehearing in Rice, and having granted rehearing, decided that its earlier decision in Rice, the 4-4 split, affirming the decision of the Iowa Supreme Court, was dismissed on the grounds that cert had been improvidently granted. So let me see if you could follow this with me, because it took me a minute too, all right? Let me say it more slowly. So rehearing was granted, and we'll hear the case again. Okay, we've got the case now. And now that we've got the case, we decided that the earlier case that we decided last year when we split 4-4, we're dismissing that case because we should have never taken that case. The writ of certiorari was improvidently granted. It was a mistake. Oops, we shouldn't have decided it. So the case is dismissed, and the decision by Justice Frankfurter is an interesting one. What's the rationale he offers? The stated basis for the decision is that the Iowa legislature has, in the meantime, passed a statute outlawing racial segregation in cemeteries in the state. The only problem is that that Iowa statute had been passed before the court heard the case the first time in 1954. It had not been just enacted in the interim. But Justice Frankfurter nevertheless claims that the statute had not been properly brought to the court's attention, and thus the case was not put into proper focus. He insisted that there's nothing unique about this dismissal, even after full argument, and he goes on to cite 60 cases in the court's history when it dismissed a case after oral argument, but is unable to find all but very few cases that were dismissed not only after they were argued, but also after they had been decided by the court. Chief Justice Earl Warren, Justice Douglas, and Justice Black dissent vehemently from Justice Frankfurter's opinion, stating clearly, "We don't agree that the circumstances relied on by the court justified this dismissal." And they go on and talk about Mrs. Rice's claim. She had, after all, sued for damages. And so it's true that going forward under the new state law, segregated cemeteries would not be countenanced under Iowa law, but Mrs. Rice and her family were entitled to damages for the unconstitutional breach of contract in violation of the 14th Amendment that had left her husband, John Rice, unburied on August 28, 1951. But Justice Frankfurter's procedural solution effectively removed the Supreme Court from dealing with the issue of segregated cemeteries in 1954, further delaying the inevitability of the end of segregation and leaving Mrs. Rice without recourse for the pain that she and her family endured. A review of Justice Warren's papers reveals that behind the scenes, this was an ugly fight. And I love stuff like this. So particularly between Chief Justice Warren and Justice Felix Frankfurter, what's interesting is if you look at Justice Frankfurter's cases, there's no paper that refers to this case at all, as though this were not controversial. But there it is in Justice Warren's papers, which is nice. Warren was furious with Frankfurter for convincing the other justices to go along with a scheme to avoid dealing with this case again on the merits with this court. And there's a particular nasty exchange over the first sentence of the dissent. The dissent was written by Justice Black, and it originally read, "We think that only extraordinary circumstances can ever justify dismissal of cases on the ground that certiorari was improvidently granted. We think only extraordinary circumstances can ever justify dismissal of cases on the ground that certiorari was improvidently granted. Our objections to such dismissals are stronger when, as here, a case has been argued and decided by the court. We do not agree that the circumstances relied on by the court justify this dismissal." Of that drafted language, Felix Frankfurter wrote, of that drafted language, the Chief Justice, that's Warren, wrote to Justice Black, the author of it, and said, "The draft of your dissent suits me perfectly." So Justice Frankfurter writes an outraged memo to the Chief Justice, and he says, "You must let me ask you to reconsider whether you should put the authority of the Chief Justice behind the opening sentences of Black's dissent. Let me say with all due respect, it's one thing for Black and Douglas to make these observations, but quite another for the Chief Justice to put his authority behind them." And it apparently had some effect. So the final language of the actual first sentence reads as follows: "We think that only very unusual circumstances can ever justify dismissal of a case on the grounds that certiorari was improvidently granted. And that's the only change, changing the word extraordinary to unusual. The kicker is that Justice Harlan actually did not participate in the case. And so it's by a 5-3 decision that the Rice case is dismissed from the court. Just three weeks later, the court unanimously decided Brown 2, the infamous all deliberate speed case, another unanimous opinion. And this is the implementation decision in which the court gave leeway for local officials to set the pace of desegregation, a move widely regarded as encouraging and ensuring massive resistance, foot dragging, and ultimately a frustration of the promise of Brown 1. So what does this tell us about today? Why does it matter that the court had only 8 justices then and has only 8 justices now? For Evelyn Rice and her children, Pamela, Tim, and Jean, for the Winnebago trial, for whom this case was truly a cause celeb, you know, if you look at the photographs from when his body was finally to be taken to Arlington and the hundreds of members of the tribe who came to shepherd his body onto the train to take them to Washington, D.C., it mattered. I visited with that family, and as I said, the pain of their father's death remains palpable for all of them, and I had the extraordinary experience of being with them when they, for the first time, opened a suitcase of his that had in it all of his medals and his uniform. And they and I learned together things about Sergeant Rice that they didn't know. Sergeant Rice was one of the soldiers who had the responsibility of telling families when their loved one had passed away. And what the Army did in those days, maybe does today, I don't know, was that they tried to have soldiers go to the home of someone who was of the same race. So it was his job always to go to Native American families and tell them that their loved one had been killed. And in the suitcase, we found the manual that guided how you learn how to do this, and the notes and the letters that Sergeant Rice received from families who he had visited because they had found him to be so compassionate and so wonderful. What the family told me was that he had re-upped and joined the Korean War because he couldn't find work at home as a Native American, even though he had served and been medaled in World War II. And so he was an extraordinary person. I went to the reservation and spoke with many people who knew him growing up, and he was regarded as the leader of that community. And so his treatment by the Sioux City Memorial Park was seen as an affront by the entire community that needed to be vindicated. And there was some vindication with him being buried in Arlington National Cemetery, but they wanted the vindication that what had happened was wrong. They wanted the Supreme Court to say that what had happened could not happen, should not happen to a citizen of this country. And so what does it matter that you have this 4-4 court? It matters to our clients. It matters to the legitimacy of our clients. We filed an amicus brief in the affirmative action case, Fisher versus University of Texas, last year. And when the case was argued, we invited our clients, African-American students from the University of Texas, to come and hear oral argument in the Supreme Court. And I have to say, these students, when I meet and talk to them, they just give me absolute hope for the future of this country. Extraordinary, poised, brilliant, courageous. And so it was that the two students that we flew to Washington, D.C. for the exciting experience of hearing their first Supreme Court argument were sitting in the courtroom when the late Justice Scalia explained that perhaps black students needed to be on a slower track and needed to go to lesser schools for their own good. And I'll never forget the feeling of it, because, you know, I was sitting with my colleagues and we were wondering, should we have brought them for this? Should we have brought them for this experience that they felt of being exposed, of humiliation, of really confusion in that moment? So what does it matter? It matters to them to have that moment vindicated with a decision from this court. Now, it so happens in the Fisher case that that's the one case that we know will not be likely a 4-4 case because there are only seven justices on it because Justice Kagan recused herself from the Fisher case last time it was heard and this time. But it's for those clients. It's for the death row clients. It's for the victims of employment discrimination, those people with real claims who, despite our organizational, ideological, and political interests, have a real concern with having their dignity vindicated by the highest court in the land. I operate by the touchstone of the LDF Director-Counsel under whom I served as a young lawyer when I was at LDF from 1988 to 1993, and that was Julius Chambers. Julius Chambers is someone you probably have never heard of, but you should have heard of. One of the most extraordinary civil rights lawyers, and the reason you haven't heard of him is because he was such an unassuming person. He never drew attention to himself, even though he litigated some of the most important civil rights cases, including the Swan versus Charlotte Mecklenburg case, the school desegregation case in North Carolina. He had been an intern at LDF when he was very young and started the first integrated black and white law firm in the South. He had his home, his car, and his office firebombed in an 18-month period. Julius was the guy that when they were in the church having the meeting and they heard the big explosion, they went outside and his car was blown up. You know, he said, let's come in and finish the meeting. There's nothing I can do about the car now. Like, that was Julius Chambers. And I had the honor to serve under him from 1988 to 1993. When I was a very young, very bright, and I thought extremely smart civil rights lawyer, so I would always come to Julius with these exciting ideas of what I was going to do. And most of the work I did was in voting rights, which has been my focus for some time. And after I would elaborately describe a case that I planned to file, Julius would always listen, and he was very quiet. He would play with rubber bands while you talked, and he would play with paper clips. And then at the end of it, he would say, "And what do your clients say?" And that became the touchstone for my vision about what it means to be a civil rights lawyer. What do your clients say? And so even though I have been deeply involved in the issues regarding the filling of this seat on the United States Supreme Court, even though I regard this as a vital issue for our democracy, I do not believe that one branch of the government should be allowed to shut down another branch of the government simply for political expediency. All that is true. But the most important aspect of it is what it means to our clients, to the people who continue to believe and count on that court. Unless we become cynical as lawyers and as law professors and as law students and as sophisticated people of the world, I can tell you that the clients with whom I interact and with whom the lawyers in my organization interact continue to believe in the Supreme Court, no matter what. They believe in the chance to have their rights vindicated. And they believe that it's better to take the chance there, even when we tell them it's not better to take the chance there, than not very often because of this history of what the Supreme Court has been able to do and because they believe in the institutions of this country. Our clients are not interested in the political maneuvering of the Senate Republicans. They don't know who Merrick Garland is, or they don't know what a swing vote is. They know they suffered a harm, one that humiliated them, one that made them question themselves, their country, the fairness of the society in which they live, the future of their children. And they're often seeking to end years of litigation and uncertainty. And the Supreme Court is supposed to provide that. And when they fail to do so, they fail their clients. But as is also clear from the Rice case, when the Supreme Court doesn't do that, it also fails itself. I'll stop there. Thank you. Some of the work we're doing in the key areas of LDF's work, which is voting rights and policing reform, and oh goodness, what don't we do is probably better to focus on. But I hope some of the questions will touch on those issues. Yes, ma'am.
Well, I actually have two questions.
Okay.
Since you raised the one about police reform, but my first question is, Do you think nowadays, when, I don't know, it seems that the GOP is so focused on the business, that rights would be cloaked in terms of business rights as opposed to really facing segregation or race?
Well, I have to say, increasingly, I think people are talking about race fairly explicitly. So what's interesting about the Rice case, you know, as I said, is that the court had just decided Shelley versus Kramer in 1948. So it's just kind of almost astonishing. But the Rice case has an important cultural gloss that I think we so often forget, which is there is such a deep, at least in that period, and for many years thereafter, decades thereafter, such a deep acceptance of segregation in worship and in burial. It's almost it was almost cultural. I mean, this was seen as so silly, you know? And so I think that the case really seemed frightening to people because this was regarded as a very intimate, right? Remember, we haven't gotten to interracial marriage yet, right? But this is seen as something very personal and very intimate. And so I think that really, it really was in its own category in some ways because of that. Remember that Thurgood Marshall and the Legal Defense Fund had been very careful to avoid the intimate in talking about ending segregation because they knew how Southerners would respond to that, right? So, you know, Brown is the product of 20-year, you know, executed strategy, right? In which Marshall and the team begin with law schools. It begins with the challenge to segregation at the school where I taught for 20 years, University of Maryland Law School in 1935. And they win that case, Murray versus Pearson. And they continue with law schools and with graduate schools, right? With the University of Oklahoma Graduate School, University of Oklahoma Law School, Missouri Law School. And the theory is because at that time, even segregationists kind of weren't against the idea of black doctors and black lawyers because who else was going to serve black people, right? Certainly not white people. So they actually pursued that as a way to begin to get at the foundations, to chip away at the foundation of segregation, because they knew that what really bothered segregationists was the idea of K through 12, of black girls and black boys going to school together, sitting in the same classroom, ultimately winding up in high school, going to the prom, and oh my God, having sex. That was literally like it went, that was the logic, you know? So it was all about that intimacy. And so they very assiduously avoided the cases involving intimate relationships because they wanted to chip at the foundation. And that's why you don't get, you know, the cases challenging interracial marriage until the 1960s, right? Because you didn't go there first, which is actually quite interesting in terms of thinking about how the litigation is working in the LGBT context, right? But certainly that was the understanding of how they approached the issue with race. And so Rice seemed like it was skipping ahead to something that was, you know, part of the kind of intimate relationships that many wanted to keep separate. Yes?
So as we sit and wait for Fisher Redux, which, unless Justice Kennedy finds religion finally, in the one case where race could be considered and that he won't find a problem with, we could have another defeat on affirmative action. And so my question is, so what separated the crits from the CLS and legal realism people was a belief in notions of rights and a commitment to equality as opportunity rather than formal equality meant something. Even if we didn't win, the understanding rights or substantive equality was something important for disenfranchised or subordinated people. And so I wonder now, in the LDF's kind of consideration, is it worth it anymore to lose if we still are backing a concept, but the idea of rights or substantive equality might still do some work, even if we no longer get the decisions from the court?
Well, just to talk about affirmative action for a second, I mean, what's most difficult to take about the whole affirmative action line of cases is that we're so often not in them as parties. And I think many people don't realize that, right? So most affirmative action cases, you know, from Bakke on, are cases that are litigated between a white student who hasn't been admitted to school and the, you know, traditionally white institution. There are no black parties. I think Grutter is maybe the only case in which intervention was permitted, and we've always tried to intervene on behalf of black students and been unsuccessful. We tried in Fisher, and we were unsuccessful, and it's one of the reasons why you know, one of the things that may happen in Fisher is that we may get a remand, in which case we will seek intervention once again. One of the things that's aggravating about it is that we have never gotten to actually create the record, like, that we would want to create, and certainly in the Texas case, which I think has, you know, facts that really need to be marshaled. The students that I talked about who are our clients for purposes of the amicus briefs, you know, tell us, and we have all the documentation of the climate on campus, of, you know, what they go through, of what it means to be in an integrated environment, of what happens, you know, in the different majors and so forth. I mean, so there's a lot of work that could be done in developing a record. And if there's one thing that I have to say most disturbs me about this particular Supreme Court, has been, you know, what I regard as a disregard for the work of litigators in building a record. Look, litigation has an educative function. You know, judges don't know everything. And particularly when judges are being selected from the very narrow pool that they're being selected from, where they're all former prosecutors, and they've all sat on the federal courts, usually federal courts of appeals, and they all pretty much went to Harvard or Yale, right? So it's extremely narrow, not only for the population, but even for the profession. So they don't know everything. Okay, you don't know everything. That's why there's a record, right? That's why there are litigators who are showing you things that maybe you don't know, you know? And I always remember Justice White saying that after Thurgood Marshall left the bench, you know, saying he showed us things that we knew and things we didn't want to know. So part of the problem with you know, looking at the affirmative action cases is that we haven't really gotten a chance to present it. And in the case where we were permitted to intervene in the Michigan case, we did prevail, right? So the Fisher case is particularly galling because we're talking about a southern state. We're talking about the school that we pushed to, that we desegregated in Sweat versus Painter in 1950, right? I mean, we have a long history with the University of Texas, and we know a lot about that school. But we haven't had the opportunity to present the case in the way that I think it should be presented. And so it's a semantic argument that is just not properly been fully explored. Is it worth it? There are some instances in which, as I said, I think that it's important just not to take certain cases to the Supreme Court, as it has been currently constituted. And sometimes you just wait, and change always happens. And I say that without, you know, meaning to be rude or disrespectful, but when I first took this job in January of 2013, you know, I did all this press and all these interviews, and people would say, tell us about this awful Supreme Court, you know, let's talk about it. Let's talk about Justice Thomas. Let's talk about Justice Alito. And I would say, you know, I'm not really that interested in talking about the court. From my perspective, leading an organization like LDF, you know, courts always change. And I reminded them about the death of Chief Justice Vinson, right, who is, you know, whose death between the first and second arguments in Brown give us Earl Warren, and thus we get Brown. And I'm just telling you about, right, the death of Justice Jackson that gives you the 4-4 in Rice. And I said, you know, things happen. And I you know, I wasn't like putting roots on anybody. I was just saying, you know, I'm just saying life happens. And my job as the leader of a civil rights organization, of a group of civil rights lawyers, is to challenge ourselves to ask, what are we teeing up for when that change happens that will be as monumental as Brown? I mean, everyone knows that's why I'm never satisfied with what we're doing. Because my thing is, what do we have in the pipeline? What are we working on? So my job coming to LDF, in addition to the work that we were already doing, was to try to create space for us to develop what I call our offense game. Because until very recently, I was a big football fan, but I think now with the concussion thing, I might have to change it. But in any case, my sense was that we had become entirely defensive, almost entirely defensive, because the challenge from the right was so strong, we had to defend what we had won. And we had left really very little room to do what LDF had originally done when there was no civil rights law, which we were all offense, right? But you gotta have an offense game, right? You can't win on just defense unless you're the 2001 Ravens, but that's it. You gotta have a little bit of an offense. So my job has been, and what we have been working on, is how do we create room, time, space, resources, connections, and then a strategy for some offensive work. And that's the place I think where I think it's worth it. And by the way, what I have said and what I tell donors, you know, about this offense game is you have to let me lose sometimes too. You know, the road to Brown from 1935 to 1954 is not a string of unbroken wins. You know, Thurgood Marshall tried all kinds of teacher pay cases in Maryland, he lost that. He tried to get him build a black high school in Baltimore County, he lost that, right? So we never talk about that. You only read what's in the casebook, and they're all winners, right? So, but to be, if you're serious about this, if you're serious about moving the needle on equality, and I am serious about moving the needle on equality, then I have to be able to experiment, and it's not an experiment if there cannot ever be failure. So part of the challenge for us is not just about like this case winds its way to the Supreme Court, like we don't even know how it got there, it's just there and now we have to do something about it, is to make sure that we're stewarding, you know, what we have to steward, but that we're also leaving part of our time and effort and resources and focus to open new vistas, because the court will change. And you may get 10 years or 20 years of a really great court that can imagine and see equality in a different way. But you know, it's a court, right? It's not a legislature. So the court can't just meet and say, you know what I think we should do? We should say equal protection includes this, right? You actually have to have worked some litigation that gives them the opportunity to do it. And so a lot of the work we've been focusing on in our strategic planning process over the last year has been that. And we've been trying some, you know, that's why we're doing some transportation. We've been trying some interesting things to kind of see whether we're onto something. And that's kind of how my vision of how I don't want to spend myopically 96% of my time focused on the Supreme Court. The Murray versus Pearson case, the case when Marshall and Charles Hamilton Houston challenged segregation at University of Maryland, Murray versus Pearson was won in municipal court in Baltimore City and affirmed by the Maryland Court of Appeals. And that case gave them the hope to say, hey, maybe we're onto something, and had them begin the journey to Missouri and then to Oklahoma and so forth. So, and that's not easy because we're all hardwired. You know, when I left LDF in 1993, I remember the first time I was in state court, because I'd been only in federal court at LDF. You know, in federal court, the room looks fantastic like this. There's water on the table. You know, it was great. And the first time I went into state court, it was like an office. I was like, where's the courtroom? You know, right? So just to reorient us ourselves, right, to, you know, because we hire the best of the best and we're elite lawyers, but to understand for the job we're doing, you know, we have to do some experimentation of a venue as well, where we begin some of these battles. That's a long answer to your question.
Please thank Sherrilyn Ifill for just a terrific lecture.